welcome to Free Life Church. We're going to give you a few minutes to join in with us. I've got David Markham with me from Truth Infusion.
Yeah, glad to be here.
So we're excited about this. And
we're going to play a song here before we get started. So just as people are joining in and tuning in, we'll give you some time to join in with us.
I've been held by the Savior. I felt fire from above. And I've been down to the river. And I ain't the same. The prodigal returned. And oh, my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. And oh, my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. Well, I'm no stranger to a prison. I've worn shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven, and I ain't going back, and I'll never be the same. Oh, my hope is in Jesus, and thank God my yesterday's gone. Oh, my sins are forgiven. And I've been washed by the blood. Well, there's a kind of thing that breaks a man. It breaks him down to his knees. I've been broken more than a time or two, but now I know how to be God's man. Oh, my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone. Oh, my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. Oh, my sins are forgiven. And I've been washed by the blood.
Amen.
We're glad you could join us here. So,
you enjoyed that? All our hope is in Jesus
right
today. So there's no other place, no other person we can turn to. So if you're watching out there, let us know where you're watching from. If you'll type in the comment section and tell us where you're at tonight. Praise God. Also, throughout the night here, if you will put prayer requests or different things like that, we will be sure to pray for those prayer requests. We'll be sure and lift them up to the Lord. Because all our hope is in Jesus. Praise God.
Yep. Yeah, timely words too. Good time to be reminded of that.
So like I said at the beginning, I got David Markham with me, and I'm Pastor James here at Free Life Church, and we're glad you could join us tonight. And we're going to be discussing Psalm 91.
Yeah.
So if you want to go ahead and
yeah, absolutely.
And get us started here.
Man, first, just thanks for having me. I was thrilled when you asked, and immediately, this is what hit my mind. You kind of gave me the liberty to just see what the Lord might be saying. I think the reason, Brother James, this hit me probably about 2 years ago, I was in a time in life where I was just struggling, just had some life things going on.
Mm-hmm.
And just to admit to folks out there, even though you're a ministry leader or a pastor, but we're not immune to life.
Right.
And so I had let life get more of me than it should. And really, I was in a place of worry and mm-hmm. and just emotionally, mentally, just kind of being overwhelmed with some things. And there was a particular day I was actually in my prayer closet. I have my closet's big enough for me to get down on my knees in. I love it. It's a place I've met with the Lord many times. And was just crying out to God about some things going on and really just looking for Him to break some things off of me. And he took me to Psalm 91, and I began to read 16 verses in this very familiar chapter to a lot of people. And this chapter is just packed full of promises. And I began to read promises that I really needed active in my life at that time, that I was just really on my knees searching for the Lord.
And that's the thing right there, active promises. That's a good word there, because
yeah.
those promises are active, and they can be active in our life.
And here's what I found out to piggyback that truth. Even though they should have been, they were not in that moment that I was in. And I'm reading these promises. This chapter has nearly 25 promises. I was just counting.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a few that I've just got bulleted here. He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the perilous pestilence. His truth will be your shield and buckler. It says, you won't fear the terror by night, the arrows by day, the pestilence that walks in darkness. No evil shall befall you. Here's a good one for today. No plague will come near your dwelling.
Amen.
And so I'm considering all these things, and I'm thinking, Lord, I know this is your word. I know this is true for me, but why do I not feel like I'm living in this?
Mm-hmm.
And something that I've learned from this process that I want to just show people that are listening and watching tonight. It's just because promises are available does not mean that I'm accessing them.
Come on now. That's a good word right there.
You know, I believe that everything that this word said is true. You know, we don't doubt that. And if you're watching this Facebook live stream, it's probably because you've got some investment in the Word of God. You believe that it's true. But just because it says it doesn't mean I'm living in it.
Right.
And I think about the fact, you know, illustrate that. If I were to have $1 million in a bank account, which should let us know right away this is a hypothetical illustration,
right?
And it was in my account, my name is on the account, my money, it's there, you know, for all the right reasons. It's available to me.
Mm-hmm.
But if I go to that ATM machine and I don't have my debit card, even though it's available to me and it's mine, if I don't have the card, I can't access it.
Yeah, that's good.
And so I began to say, Lord, okay, your promises are here. Psalm 91, these are the things that I'm missing in this moment a couple of years ago. Maybe there's some people in this corona crisis they're living in that they're looking for some stability and some promises to ring true.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm looking at Psalm 91, and I realized in that prayer closet that day that the only part of Psalm 91 that falls to me as a responsibility is verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of a repeat of verse 1 that you find in verse 9. Basically, the same words are found. So I realized that the secret to me receiving and living in these promises, and really it's not just Psalm 91, it's any of these promises in this book,
right,
was held in the only part of Psalm 91 that I have any responsibility with.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to read verse 1,
yeah,
and then just share with what God revealed to me about verse 1 that opens up the rest of the psalm. And man, changed the way I saw some things in the Word of God. So awesome when he does that.
If you have your Bibles there, go with us to Psalm 91. We want to share with you some important truths out of this and really show you how to take God's Word. And as it says in John chapter 1, verse 14, the Word became flesh mm-hmm. and dwelt among us. And so His Word can become flesh in our life,
and can become
part of who we are. It can come in and just totally change how we see things. It can totally change how we experience things. And it's amazing to take God's Word into daily active our life. So
right.
Go ahead and let's read this.
Well,
this
just verse 1, really. And really, I want to focus in today, Pastor, on just the beginning of verse 1. And here's what verse 1 says. Psalm 91, verse 1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High
mm-hmm.
shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So once you get to shall abide under the shadow, we're already talking about benefits.
Yes.
The rest of this psalm is the list of benefits and blessings that we are able to receive for He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High.
Dwells.
Yeah.
Now that word there, dwells, have you ever looked it up in Hebrew?
Yes, that word study of that word is what really set this thing off for me. And so it really is, it's like the linchpin that this turned on whenever God was revealing to me what this was about. So
yeah,
absolutely, that's something that I was going to deal with.
Good deal. Well, we'll keep on going here then.
Yeah, so He who dwells in the secret place, the first thing that I asked the Lord was, tell me, show me about this secret place, because, you know, I don't know, when I was beginning to look at this, I wasn't exactly sure what that was, but I knew that it was important because I needed to get there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I want to receive this stuff and be able to live in these promises, I got to get to the secret place.
That's right.
I remembered that this was David, the psalmist, writing this, and in his time, they met with the Lord at the tabernacle.
Mm.
They didn't have the temple in place yet now, and the secret place in his day was a physical location on planet Earth. It was an actual place. And he was regarding the Holy of Holies within the tabernacle. That was also known as the secret place.
Yes.
Probably known that to be that because only one time of year, Pastor, we don't have to go into all this teaching, was a man allowed in that place.
Mm-hmm.
The secret place was the Holy of Holies, and in that secret place, two things primarily. Number one, in the physical sense, the Ark of the Covenant was there.
Right.
But in a much more powerful and real sense, the Holy of Holies, the secret place, represented where the presence of God was.
Yes, the Shekinah.
The Shekinah,
yes,
glory, the presence of God was in that secret place. So you and I, thank God, don't have to go to a tabernacle or a temple to find the presence of God.
Mm-hmm.
In 2020. If you belong to Him, you have become that temple.
Yeah.
We are that temple of the Holy Spirit. We
are
that tabernacle, right, where the presence of God is. So the beauty is that He's there.
Mm-hmm.
And where He has promised to be, He will be. He keeps up His end of the deal, right?
Amen.
So even when I'm in a place in my life where I don't feel like I feel Him, or I'm connected to Him the way I want to be, or I used to be, or what have you, God's always going to be where He promised He would be.
Mm-hmm.
And if I am that tabernacle, I am that dwelling, I'm that child of God, here He is. Here He is, whether I feel Him or not. Sometimes my feelings,
right,
they'll lie to me.
That's right.
They'll lie to me. So we can't rely on feelings. We rely on these promises. So that's the secret place. Really, more than the Holy of Holies, it is the presence of God, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But let's talk about the word dwell, because that's real, like I said, that's where I was just ready to run a lap in my closet that day.
Man.
I'm looking at this word, and when we look at it in the English, we think of dwell as a place you reside, the place where you live.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's not really the Hebrew concept. It's bigger than that. It's better than that, you know. The Hebrew concept really means to sit down. To dwell in the Hebrew means to sit, to take a seat.
Mm-hmm.
But more so even than that, as I'm studying this, because I'm no Hebrew theologian. I have to read behind people that are. more than just to sit down, it means to do so in such a way that you are resting.
Yeah.
It means to relax or to repose. Because I was thinking about places you might sit down that aren't so restful.
Mm-hmm.
Been to the dentist a little bit lately. There's a lot of seats in the dentist office. Ain't a lot of resting
There's
going
no rest
on in
there.
Amen.
That's right.
So it's not that type of seat, but it's a seat where, man, I think about my recliner at home, or this seat's very comfortable. I could rest right here. But it's to take a load off.
Yeah.
Relax. And that's amazingly important when we consider what I believe the psalmist is trying to let us know. If you want to get involved in these promises in such a way that the Word of God is active, I like the way that we brought that out earlier, active in your life, the key that unlocks the door, the debit card that gives me access to the promise in this account, is that I've got to learn how to sit down and rest.
And rest, yes.
In the presence of God.
And that rest is key in these days we're living in. Because it's crazy out there.
Yeah.
You know, with all the things going on and the fear that tries to grip us on a daily scale, you know, that fear comes in. And, you know, you could be the most spiritual person on the planet and you still have to deal with fear.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody does in some way, some facet. Fear will try to grip us and destroy our life.
I think some people are naturally prone to being fearful people.
Right.
Anxious folks. And even if you're not that person, when you're in an unprecedented moment or life throws you a curveball you weren't expecting,
right?
You'll find yourself in that place.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you're right. Nobody gets away with not having to learn how to deal with anxiety and fear on some level in our lives. And I think this is a beautiful picture of how we do that in this. So
what gives us rest in this, I guess you could say in the secret place, what gives us rest would be God's presence being there.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, there is no peace apart from the Prince of Peace.
Amen.
This worldly concept of peace is just, there's not argument going on. But how many married folks out there have been in a fight with your spouse, but nobody's talking? No idea why that just started doing that. Tell me what to do. I don't know why that just started happening. That's crazy.
It's probably Siri. She wanted to dial it for you.
It's
know,
off and now. Yeah. I must have said something that activated her.
That's right.
But how many of you have been in an argument with your spouse and you got to a place where nobody was talking? Right? So there's no active arguing going on, but that doesn't mean there's peace in the house.
Right.
Far from it. Nobody's feeling at ease. Amen. There's a lot of people out there that are amening right now. So just because there's not active argument going on, doesn't mean there's peace. Just because Israel's not actively fighting Iran at war right now doesn't mean there's peace.
So true.
So it requires God to have real peace.
Yeah.
The world's concepts of peace, not so much, right?
That's right. You know, I was preaching a few years ago, and I said there is no, outside of God's presence, there is no peace. And peace is not the absence of the problems, but it's actually in the presence of the Lord. And I thought that was so awesome, the way the Holy Spirit brought that out, you know.
And that's absolutely, it dovetails perfectly into what we're talking about for someone who's dwelling in the secret place.
Yes.
I asked a question of the Lord about this moment of me kind of studying into this, and that was this. If you're wanting me to take a seat, sit down and repose and rest in my presence, my question was then, Lord, in the Holy of Holies, there is no chair to sit down in. Right? Only one piece of furniture there. And here's the response of the Lord that sent me on another amazing path. He said, you're right, David, there's no chair in the Holy of Holies, but there is a seat.
Yes.
There is a seat in the Holy of Holies. And I had to take some time to look at the mercy seat. Now, if you're not familiar with the Ark of the Covenant, and if you've seen Indiana Jones, you know what I'm talking about. Or if you've read some of these passages of Scripture, you understand the Ark of the Covenant. The lid of the Ark of the Covenant was called the mercy seat.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So, and here's what I found this out just in studying. All of the instruments and pieces of furniture and gold-covered and handcrafted stuff that was around the tabernacle of the temple, the most expensive one item in all of the tabernacle ground proper was the mercy seat. So I wrote these stats down. This was an estimate, about 3.8 feet long, 2.2 feet wide, about an inch or so thick, solid gold. Solid gold. And today's estimate would have been over $2 million worth of gold. Was just the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat. So, David, how would you know that he's referring to the mercy seat at all? Well, let me read you verse 4 in Psalm 91. It says this, he shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will take refuge. If you've ever seen a picture of the mercy seat,
there's wings.
The cherubim are seated there as God directed, and their wings are overcast in the mercy seat. So there it is. You're under the wings, you'll take refuge.
Amen.
So here's the mercy seat. The mercy seat in David's time was the place on planet Earth that God met with man. What do we mean by that? When the high priest would come into the Holy of Holies once a year with the blood of a special sacrifice, he would splash that blood on the mercy seat. And if he did it the right way, the way God had required, God would roll back sin for another year. That never forgave a single sin. But God would just kind of put it up on the shelf and say, okay, I'll deal with that later. And next year would come around, I'll deal with that later. But at the mercy seat, when the blood hit the mercy seat, that's where God met with man. It was the place of the blood, and it was the place on planet Earth that God and man would meet.
Yes.
The mercy seat. What we have in the mercy seat, not only as an expensive item monetarily, but spiritually, there was nothing of more value than what happened in that place for Israel and as it represents for us today through Jesus Christ, which that's what I want to show you. Because the mercy seat and that blood, that place of the blood, painted a picture of a word we don't use enough in the church today, propitiation. It's a great theological word. Propitiation simply means this. It is the act of turning God's wrath away from our sin.
Amen.
So when the high priest would sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat, God would remove his wrath for one more year from the children of Israel in their sin. It's the Day of Atonement.
Mm-hmm.
Everything in the Old Testament was representative of what was coming.
Yes.
Amen.
If you're watching out there and you've experienced God's mercy, we would like for you to put that down in the comment section.
Yes. Amen.
And if you will, go ahead and like and share this post here, and let's get the word out, because I think the world's in desperate need of mercy right now during this time. You know, we need God's mercy because, and the Bible gives us the promise that where sin abounds, grace abounds much more.
Right.
You know, and there's no way to get to grace except through mercy. Because when Jesus, you know, when he died on the cross for our sins, he literally took that blood.
Yep.
And there is a spiritual trail of that blood up
blood
to
trail.
Heaven, to the heavenly mercy seat.
Yeah.
Where he put it on there.
Absolutely.
For us forever.
Hey, yeah, man, you're setting me up perfect. And we ain't even practiced this. This is
That's
beautiful.
Right.
And let me take us to Romans chapter 3. The concept of the mercy seat, man, God just lit me up with this teaching. And the concept of propitiation. I want to read just a couple of verses out of Romans chapter 3. This exactly what you just set up, Pastor. And we'll start with verse 23. It's a very familiar verse. So this is Romans 3, verse 23. Says, "For all have sinned, fallen short of the glory of God." And then he goes on to explain just what you were saying. In verse 24, "being justified freely by his grace," that's a capital H, that's talking about Jesus.
Amen.
"Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Now I want you to see verse 25, "whom God set forth as a propitiation," just talked about that word, "by his blood." So there's the word actually laid out in descriptive form with what his blood did in buying our salvation, forgiving us of sin, propitiation. It's the Greek word hilasterion. All right?
He's getting deep now, folks.
Now watch this.
Hold on to your seats.
Somebody in Faceland world is about to run a lap. The Greek word hilasterion is the word that means mercy seat.
Mm-hmm.
So here's what it's really saying if we use that definition of the Greek word. Jesus, whom God set forth as the mercy seat by his blood. See, what the mercy seat of the Old Testament that the psalmist was talking about in Psalm 91, what it was representing, what it was typifying, was what Jesus manifested on earth when he died on the cross, and through his blood, he became my mercy seat.
Hallelujah.
He became your mercy seat.
We're seated with Christ heavenly places.
Brother, I got it written down right there. That's exactly right. So we got this concept of sitting, resting, reposing in the presence of God.
Mm-hmm.
And you're referring to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. Let me read this. Man, Pastor, I'm going to just read it off of this page right here. "But God,
hallelujah,
who is rich in mercy, because of his great love, with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses," watch this now, "made us alive together with Christ." Who's the us? You and Jesus. "Made us alive together with Christ," it says in parentheses, "for by grace you have been saved." Now watch this. "He raised us up together."
Amen.
I love in Romans chapter 6, we were buried, we were crucified with Christ, buried with Christ, raised to walk in newness of life. We did this with him.
Mm-hmm.
And so here's where it comes together, what you just said. "And he made us," me and Jesus, you and Jesus, "sit together in heavenly places in Jesus Christ." When we got saved, God set us in Christ, the mercy seat.
Praise God. Say that with me. Say, "I'm seated."
Yes.
"With Christ."
With Christ.
"In heavenly places."
That's right.
Say, "I'm seated in mercy," right out there.
Amen.
"I'm seated in mercy."
In mercy.
"And because God's mercies were not consumed." Praise God, because they're new every morning.
What a beautiful promise. What an amazing picture. He is our mercy seat. God set us in Christ in the mercy seat in heavenly places.
Mm-hmm.
And then God put on my heart, 2 Corinthians 1:20, familiar verse, says this, "For all the promises of God are in him."
Yes.
Right? "For all the promises of God in him
in
are
him.
Yes, and in him amen, to the glory of God through us." So we go back to where we started with this in Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place, he who sits down
in Christ, in the mercy seat. When you are seated in Christ, all the promises of Psalm 91 are yes and amen when we are seated in Him.
Amen. So, I want to take a small side trip on this.
Come on.
Talking about the mercy seat has got me fired up because I started thinking about now when we encounter enemies in our life. If you flip over to Psalm 23, you notice that there is a table, and normally at tables there's seats.
Mm-hmm.
So right there in the presence of our enemy, where God prepares a table before us, we're sitting in the mercy, and the mercy is what enables us to overcome the enemy because of what Jesus did.
Yeah, in the presence of the enemies, we're feasting the Father's supply, seated
Hallelujah.
In Christ. Man, and so much of the Word just comes alive through these concepts because it rings true throughout. I'm sitting there in my closet that day, worn out with where I allowed my mind and my emotions to get in the life experiences I was going through. And God opens this stuff up to me over some time. You know, it didn't happen all at once, obviously. I did some study, and the more He showed me, the more He unfolded, the more I was understanding about where I was missing things.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what I realized. I said this a minute ago. When I got saved, when you got saved, God the Father set us on the mercy seat, His Son. And in that moment, all the promises became ours.
Mm-hmm.
So how did I end up in my closet that day feeling like these promises which were available were not accessible? It's because we have a big tendency to get up off the mercy seat and to go try to fix this on my own. I got an issue that I don't know what to do with, so I go try to figure out how I'm going to handle this. What am I going to do? How do I fix this? When I go to start working on things that Jesus has already fixed, when I go to try to fix problems that He's already paid the price for, all I'm doing now is going out there and working and wearing myself out.
Yeah.
God's saying, come on back into the secret place and sit down. I've already got this handled for you.
I've
already got promises laid out to handle this problem for you. Would you come take a break, take a load off, sit down? My Son's already dealt with this for you. Come rest. Come dwell. Come rest and let my promises be true and ring true for you again.
Praise God. You know, that goes right along with Matthew chapter 11. I'm going to actually read it out of the Message Bible. And I don't study out of this translation, but I like the way it says some things. So if you go over with me to Matthew chapter 11.
Yeah.
And let's look at this. In verse 28, exactly what you're saying here, it says, are you tired, worn out,
come on,
burned out on religion? I've never seen religion save anybody. Now, I've seen a relationship with Jesus Christ save somebody, but I've never seen religion save anyone. But it says, are you burned out on religion? It says, come to me. This is Jesus talking in red letters. He said, get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest.
Come on.
Walk with me and work with me. Now, you also have to work with the Lord. He says, watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace.
Oh, yeah.
I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company or abide. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly.
Man.
Don't you want to live freely and lightly today?
Sure.
That's found in the shadow of the Almighty.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that, you know, there's a song by the Sensational Nightingales, black gospel group, and they would sing, every promise in the book is mine, every chapter, every verse, every line, all are blessings of His love divine, every promise in the book is mine. They're available, but to access them, we got to do it His way.
Yeah.
You know, He's not interested in us working to achieve something that Christ has already achieved and thereby somehow trying to receive some glory for myself, say, look, here's how I did it. Look, God, look what I just did. He's not wanting to share glory with me or you.
Mm-hmm.
His glory belongs to Him. Jesus has already accomplished. He said, it is finished. The work's done. Right? So I believe what you read there in that Message translation is true. We do have a part we have to play in this. We have a responsibility in this. We do work with Him in this.
Co-laborers.
But and here is, I believe, our work put your faith on me, believe in me. Paul said it like this in Colossians 2, verse 6, as you have received him, in that way walk in him.
Mm-hmm.
So how did I receive him? By faith. God did all the rest of the work. Man, when my faith is on him as my all in all, he's enough.
Yeah.
And I can rest in that. And all these promises become yes and amen. And I'm going to make it through. Amen.
Amen. Let's see what different people has been posting here. Let's see. We got someone. Preach, preacher. Come on. We got, someone's asking if we're 6 feet.
Yes, we are.
Yeah.
It may not tell from the camera, right? But absolutely. Thank you for that. And we did use hand sanitizer.
Someone said the camera doesn't go that wide. That's funny. So grateful. God's mercy's new for me every day.
Amen.
So we got a few people here chiming in. You know, put a time where God has come through and put you in rest or put you at ease. Or if you have a prayer request where you need us to pray for something, you can put that in there or message us. And we'd be glad to pray for you and hook up our faith with yours. Because listen, yeah. During this time, the body of Christ is scattered.
Mm-hmm.
And there's lots of people that are uncertain about what's going on. And they need someone to really come alongside them and help them and strengthen them. And so we, as the body of Christ, everybody, no matter what denomination,
definitely.
Whatever you're into, as long as Jesus is your Lord, we ought to be all coming together and encouraging each other, because it's not about competition. It's not about competing, but it's about completing.
Yeah. Oh, good.
We need to complete the work of Christ.
Put that on a t-shirt. That'd be a good
right.
one. You know, I think that God's doing so many things in these days. Boy, folks are, we don't like it when our routines get messed up.
Right.
And God has just, he's used this crisis that we're dealing with to blow us up out of our comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
And out of our routines, but it's forced us to tear down walls that we may not have torn down otherwise, to reach across some barriers that we may not have reached across before. It's making us do things differently. You know, Pastor, I know as pastors who are my earthly heroes are pastors, and you plan, you know, when the things are normal a week ahead of time, here's what we want to do next month, here's what I'm thinking the church will be 6 months from now, a year from now. In these days, we don't have that luxury. We don't know what next week's going to look like.
Mm-hmm.
And so things are different for everybody. But in that, I think God is reaching out through avenues like this one right here and touching more folks than we probably ever would have touched doing it our normal ways.
Right.
He's reaching it through medium and media that we don't usually use, mm-hmm. or in ways we don't usually use them. And he's doing it, man. Glory to be is going to him in ways it's not gone before. And God's reaching people in ways he's never reached them before. And if this is how he's going to do it, he's God. He gets what he wants. I'm just glad to be in the room and watch him work.
Amen. Well, what are some practical things, David, that that they could do out there during this crisis, the coronavirus? They've got the different rules and things in place. You know, so the body of Christ doesn't look like it normally does.
Yeah.
So what are some ways that they could reach out to other believers, or even to the lost during this time?
I think that we have to take advantage of amazing resources.
Mm-hmm.
If these circumstances had happened 20 years ago, man, what kind of resources do we have now that we didn't have 20 years ago?
So true.
So we're in these isolation moments or a shelter in place, and Cass County today started shelter in place. So it's going widespread for necessary reasons. But where you are, use the resources that you have. Everybody nowadays has a phone and you can call somebody. Everybody mm-hmm. nowadays can text or message somebody through social media. Do that. Everybody has if you don't know how to find a sermon to listen to nowadays, you aren't trying. Because on a Sunday morning, you can be in on so many church services now that you never could have done before. So you've got word coming to you, and when God blesses you with a verse or a moment that just lights you up with some kind of word that God's given you, man, he's going to put somebody on your heart to share that with.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps this is what you need to do, because you got time at home and you're not pressed to get up, get ready, go to work, and get into your normal routines. Make a list of people by name that you need to be praying for.
Come on, that's a good one there.
Man, bombard heaven with names And, you know, let's get off of me. I've got stuff I need to pray for me, but you know what? I need to be doing more of that. I need to be praying for you.
Mm-hmm.
Pastor, you're leading folks and having to do it in ways you weren't planning on having to do 3 weeks ago, and we need to be praying for our pastors. We need to be encouraging our pastors. So you can utilize the mediums and the opportunities that we have and resources we have to encourage, to reach out, to bless. I know one guy, I'm not going to call his name. Here's what he's been doing these last few weeks. And this may not sound like a big deal to somebody, but it's a big deal for him. Every day he is posting a verse. That's a new thing for him. And it's blessed me.
Yeah.
That I know he's doing it. And if that's what you think is a small thing, but God's called you to it, little is much when God is in it.
Right.
Listen to what he's saying and do it, and he will expand the territory. He will apply the increase to it.
Mm-hmm. So what we're saying here tonight is don't clock out.
Please.
Don't clock out and say, church is going to happen. I'll get back to my normal routine, because you may not. You don't know what the future holds.
Yeah.
You know, so God may be trying to do something new in you. He may be trying to make a prayer warrior out of you.
Sure.
He may try to get you deeper rooted in the Word of God. And we got to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit and see. The Bible says He give us witty inventions.
Yes.
In other words, God will give us creativity if we'll just lean on, rely upon Him, and not try to do things the normal way. You know, sometimes we got to look for the unnatural way, the unnormal way, if that's a word, you know, and step out of the box. Because Christianity today, before this happened, has had a box.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew the borders of that box, and they preached into that box, and they didn't go outside that box. But if we'll step outside and say, Lord, give us creative ideas, show us how to share the gospel with people around us, and show us how to still go deeper with you, because the Great Commission can be summed up in four things.
Come on.
It's just like the legs of a chair. First one is, read your Bible.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is pray, which includes worship and praise and all that.
Absolutely.
That's a type of prayer. The third one is go to church. Well, you can't necessarily go to a building, but you can still go to a YouTube video or a Facebook video or a live stream, something going on, and go to church that way.
Yeah, but stay plugged in.
Stay plugged
in.
And that fourth leg is share your faith.
Got to.
If you have all of those in place, you will be an on-fire Christian. You won't find Christianity boring, and you'll be going forward of what God has for you to do, which is to share the gospel. So you can still find creative ways to do that during this time, and I think the best place to find the creative solutions is inside of the secret place.
Absolutely, yeah.
Psalm 91.
Yeah, listen for His voice. He'll tell you. If you are available and willing, He'll give you an assignment.
Amen.
He's ready for us to all go to work. I remember a quote just now, something you said spurred me to remember this, by Gypsy Smith. He said there are actually five gospels: Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and you. And most people will never read the first four.
Come on, that's good.
Think about it. You may be the only gospel of Jesus Christ that somebody will read in these days of chaos and confusion. So be the gospel message. Be the preacher. If you're saved, you're called to be a minister.
Amen.
This isn't the only minister in this church. I promise you that.
Listen to what he's saying.
It is full. He's just the one that's supposed to be feeding you and edifying you from as the leader and the under-shepherd here. You are the ministers of this church. And if you're willing, God's going to give you an assignment and an opportunity.
Amen. Well, we're gonna get David to pray for you. And, you know, we just want to encourage you. Don't clock out.
Yes.
Get ready for what God's doing in these days and these times we're living in, because you were born for such a time as this.
Amen.
This is the season of God, and He's got great things planned. I'm excited about the season we're in and where God's taking us. And we're going to ride the waves of the Holy Spirit.
Sure.
So go ahead and let's pray. If you're out there, just stretch your hand this way and receive what He's going to pray for you.
Amen. Lord, we just say thank you. We start with that, just a
thank you,
confession of praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you that we are upright and we are breathing and we are listening and we are hearing and we are receiving. Thank you, God, that you've said the Holy Spirit would lead us into all truth. And tonight, we're all getting in on that. Mm-hmm. Lord, I thank you that in days of confusion and chaos, you have created opportunity. And there is much opportunity for those that are willing to look for it. And you are a God that can. Your word tells us that you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ask or think. So, Lord, I'm asking, Lord, that you would empower those that have taken the time to tune in, whether it's live or maybe later when somebody watches this. And God, I'm asking, because you said we could ask, that you would empower them with not only the Holy Spirit to perform it, but the plan, the invention of your ministry to get out there and make a difference. Maybe things that nobody else ever knows that they're doing. But God, you know. And Father, you've given us the command to not grow weary in doing good. Because in due time, we will reap a harvest if we're willing to sow into you, Lord. We're willing. So Holy Spirit, we thank you for the opportunity that is here. There may be businesses that have had to shut down, schools that are closed. Lord, the normal things of life that don't look normal now. But God, you are not out of business. And you are not off of the throne, and you haven't lost an ounce of power, and you are not doing damage control. God, you have a plan, and you are seeing it through, and you are willing for us to be a part of it. God, let us get in on your work.
Hallelujah.
In these days, Father, for the needy, for the widows, for the broken, for the hurting, for the unhealthy, for the confused, God, would you raise up these ministers in these days to do a work they never saw coming 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, but God, now you are showing them what you are calling them for in this moment, Lord. Help us to learn how to sit and rest and dwell in your presence to receive your plan and your sending us out. As your commission is going forth, not only just in these days, but especially in these days. You are doing it, God. You are doing it, and you never fail.
Yes, Lord.
And you always win. And you're going to keep on keeping on, Lord. Let us get in on that, we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen. I got a couple things on my heart, too. We'll just stay in this vein. There's a few categories of people I want to pray for.
Yep.
Father, I pray right now, first off, for the pastors and ministers out there.
Right.
Y'all just join in with me as we pray. And Lord, we pray for a supernatural strength over pastors and ministers and those who are doing things different. Lord, we pray for witty inventions for them.
Amen.
Lord, we pray right now for wisdom. According to James 1:5, Father, give them wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, lead and guide them into all truth. Lord, I pray that any kind of depression or oppression that's trying to come upon their life because of the uncertainty of things, Lord, I pray it would lift right now and the presence of God would flow in to that room wherever
Settle
they're at right now,
Lord.
And I just thank you, Lord. It'll bring a supernatural rest into their life and a hope, Father, an expectation that everything's going to be all right,
Amen.
Lord. I pray right now also for all the families at home, Lord, the moms and the dads and the ones that are watching kids, Lord. The kids are out of school right now. That just came up in my heart, Lord, as we were praying here, that you would supernaturally strengthen them, quicken them in their mortal body. Father, strengthen them in their inner man and help them to be able to do school with these kids.
Yeah.
Help them, Lord, to walk in a supernatural peace, Lord. Oh, we just thank you, Father, for that peace rising up when the kids may be going this way and that way and all these kind of things are happening. Lord, I just thank you that you step in. And Lord, that you give a grace in this season in the name of Jesus. Father, also for all of our medical people, Lord, we continue to lift them up. And we pray right now that no sickness would come upon them, that they would be protected. No evil shall befall them. No plague will come near their dwelling. Lord, we thank you right now for helping them, giving them wisdom. We thank you for a vaccine, speedy time. In Jesus' name, Lord, speedily let it come. And I just thank you for wisdom for those people that is involved in making this thing to just disperse. And we just believe you, Lord, for all these things that you're working. Even when we don't see it, he's working.
Thank you, Lord.
Even when we don't feel it, he's working. And he never sleeps. He never slumbers. He never stops working.
Thank you, God.
And we just thank you, Father. Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, thank you for joining us tonight at Free Life Church. Thank you, David, for coming out and sharing with us. Really enjoyed
it. Privileged.
God bless you. We'll